Hello everyone, I'm Lou Holder, DC area sportscaster and professor here at Prince George's Community College. I'm coming to you from the PGCC-TV studios on the Largo campus to introduce a wonderful forum recently conducted entitled The Changing Face of Communications, Its Effects on Business and Life. To give some thoughts on this topic, we invited Fox 5 Morning News anchors Allison Seymour and Wisdom Martin. Now with some help from some of the mass communication students here at Prince George's Community College, please enjoy this very informative and entertaining dialogue around this relevant topic.
Books, newspapers, magazines were America's only mass media for 250 years after the first American book was published in 1640. The first half of the 20th century brought four types of media: recording, radio, movies, and TV, all in fewer than 50 years. The late 20th century addition to the media mix, of course, has been the internet. The face of how we communicate, not just through the vehicles of mass media, but in our own one-on-one interactions, is changing at a rapid pace. Due in large part to social media, the lines are becoming increasingly blurred on what is journalism and what is fraudulent news. Interpersonal communications and speech are being impacted, both good and bad, by the changing face of communications. To give some insight and perspective on how these changes are affecting business and life, please welcome WTTG Fox 5 Morning News anchors Allison Seymour and Wisdom Martin, and our moderator, Professor Lou Holder.
Thank you so much. That was Aaron Thacker, one of our students. I've done a lot of things in my career, but one thing I want is his voice. So when I was putting this program together, I said I need to have somebody who sounds like James Earl Jones, the voice of God. And Aaron is one of the students here at Prince George's Community College that has excelled and is now moving up, wants to do his own voiceover work. So Aaron, thank you so much for that introduction.
Thank you, Aaron Thacker.
All right, so this panel is about the changing face of communications. And I thought no better than to have two of my good friends and colleagues when I used to work at Fox, Allison, Wisdom, and myself. We used to cut it up all the time, all the time. And they're good people, they're good friends, and I thought it would be very, very poignant to have them come to the college to talk about their experience. So I think I'm gonna start there. We're here at Prince George's Community College. I'm very proud of this place. It has changed my life as far as teaching. But I want to ask the first question to both of you. How did your education, or where you went to school, how did that mold you into the journalist and broadcaster you are today? Allison?
Good afternoon, everybody. We're happy to be here today. I do want to note that you had your picture up on the monitor when they were doing the intro, but we didn't have any picture up on it.
Your pictures have been blasted all over this campus.
Okay.
This community, everybody's like coming up to me, Allison and Wisdom.
You noticed that, Wiz?
I did see that.
Okay, now that the air is clear about that. Honestly, being on this campus reminds me of my college experience at Hampton University, because really what it did for me, someone mentioned the introduction. When I was there, there was no Scripps Howard School of Journalism. There was one building and we shared it with theater, and the program wasn't what it is today. But what I will say that Hampton gave me was the confidence to go out and try to get that first job. Hampton, being an historically black university, gave me that feeling like I could do just about anything that I set my mind to. So my experience is different. When I went to USC for a graduate degree, it was different. It was more business. I got the resume reel I really needed and all of that. It was a different experience at a large state school. But my undergraduate experience at Hampton was what helped to make me who I am today. It was like a warm hug before being kicked out into a cold, big world that doesn't care as much about you as my professors did there. So that's what my school meant for me.
How about you, Wisdom?
And I think the same thing at Jackson State, also at HBCU, the way that they take care of the students when they're there. And make no mistake about it, I got no problem with no school. I'm all about education on any level, wherever you can get it, whatever you can pay for, go get it, all right? But for me, I was the kind of student that needed a lot of nurturing because I wasn't the greatest student in the world, and I feel like I got that nurturing at Jackson State University because my parents went there, my grandparents went there, my cousins went there, I got cousins on, my wife went there, her father taught there, my mother-in-law went there, her brother went there, her sister went there.
We get it.
Okay, so you get it. So basically, it's a family environment, all right? Jackson State was a family environment for me, and I was sharing the story earlier about how I got the start in the business is because of one of my classmates was already working in TV because she was super duper smart, and she was already working in TV in front of the camera as a sophomore at the TV station in Jackson. And I got the job because we were in class one day, and she told me about an entry-level job at the ABC station in Jackson, Mississippi. So she had talked me up, and I went in there. It was an entry-level job running the teleprompter, which is paper. They don't do that anymore. Tape and paper together in machines so the anchors could read it. And I worked my way up from that to photographer and editor and all this other stuff. So it was a nurturing environment that taught me you got to be aggressive. You got to be a step ahead of everybody else if you want the job. You got to be willing to sacrifice. I mean, many a nights that I would sacrifice and not go out and party. I did get my party on, but a lot of times I couldn't party because I had other things to do, and I was focused on what I was doing. So the Jackson State environment for me, bottom line, it was all about family and nurturing, and they set me up to where I am today.
Okay, good. Guys, our industry is under attack. It's very tumultuous times to be in the media. The lines are so blurred now between what is journalism and what is fraudulent news. The new administration talks about fake news almost every day. We don't know where to turn as far as who to believe. Everybody has a microphone. Everybody has a place to get out news. How has that impacted what you guys do for a living, knowing that there's so many others out there that want the attention, and there's so many people out there in a good way that gives them a shot to get into the business, but in a bad way are probably misusing the media?
I think it's making us stronger, and it will make us better. I think for a long time, you just, like my parents' generation, they turned on Walter Cronkite at, hi, Dr. Dukes. They turned on the nightly news. It was, you got your source from that one person, you read your newspaper. Then it just, you know, there's local news, so you go to that only. And with this administration, you do see a challenge to what's real. Okay, I thought the Washington Post was, that's where I was supposed to get my news. Mm-hmm. No, well, that's fake news. So now, or Channel 5 or the networks especially, no, that's fake news. So I think the onus is on us even more to make sure that our sources are checked and double checked, that we've become a society that looks at something on our cell phone and takes it for fact without double checking and all that. And I do that as a normal person. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to my job, you've got to make sure that you are absolutely right, because the business is an honorable business, but it is under attack. And so therefore, just like anything else, if your character is under attack, if your position is under attack, you stand and fight. So it makes you better and stronger. And this is a challenge, and I believe it's unprecedented in my career, for sure. But it will make us stronger.
Yeah. I agree with that. And I also want to throw in the social media aspect as well, because a lot of times, a lot of people, because of the way society is today, the instant gratification or instant information, if you will, a lot of stuff is on social media. Everything goes to social media. People put out press releases on social media. So at some point during this whole thing, during the evolution of television news, we kind of got pushed to the back, as in television people, we kind of got pushed to the back where Twitter and internet and everything is instant, apps and all this kind of stuff kind of pushed us to the back. So just like Allison said, you just got to keep doing your thing, and you just got to keep above the fray, and you got to keep a level of integrity and be respectable and know that, you know, people need to know that when they turn to you, you're a person of character, and that you have done your homework, and that what you're saying is legit, and you're not some fly-by-night person, you're not some fake news. I'm getting my information from Allison Seymour, so I know it's legit, because I know she did the work, and I know she's been here, she's a DC person, so I know when I turn on that TV and I see her, I know what I'm getting. So you just gotta keep that going and not be distracted by, you know, what's happening on social media, trolling on social media and all this other stuff.
Good, thanks. I wanna take it from the macro to the micro a little bit. One of the classes taught here is interpersonal communication. And in the class, we talk about the erosion of those little devices that we have in our pockets and how they are eroding the way we communicate. So the title of the forum was Business and Life. So it has become very apparent that we don't even like to communicate with people anymore. You can get your groceries, your banking, you can even get your spouse online, right? There's so many places people do not want, they'd rather go through the drive-thru than talk to somebody because communication with somebody is messy. You can't clean it up like you can with your device. But it also is changing the way we communicate. People are not writing full sentences anymore. People, thank you letters, people are writing them like they're texts. You know, so as far as life, how has it affected you guys as far as what you do off the air and what you do on the air and how you communicate?
I don't have time to talk to nobody. So I love it. Text me if you need to get in touch with
me. Wiz? I got you.
Right. I feel like this is just what you see on the top is what's happening, you know, all the stuff that's happening on the bottom. So for me, at this point in my life, with three kids, with a husband who commutes to and from New York in the week, it's, you can look at something half full or half empty. Mm-hmm. For me, it's easier for you to get in touch with me when you need to by just sending me a quick text. I'm a certain age that we're gonna get the details probably a quick phone call or an email, what have you, but I feel like it's just a sign of the times. For whatever reason, there are more distractions, we're doing all this, and it's just a way to facilitate communication. Now, not meaningful communication. I'm not going to, if I were single today, I can't even imagine single people like trying to find a date or get to know each other. I'm seeing it through my 16-year-old daughter. They meet people on, you know, I'm on Snapchat, and then add me on Snapchat, and all of a sudden you're friends with somebody. And I understand what you're saying, but I think for working people, it's just in how you manage it. Life is how you manage yourself. You know, you can choose to be, I'm mopey and sad, or you could choose happiness. You could choose to be tied to your phones or whatever, or you can choose not to. But I think we're at a point in society where you make a choice, and it doesn't have to be a negative choice.
Well said.
I just want to add that it's everything in moderation. The phone and the technology is all part of evolution. The texting and all the social media, all this stuff, is part of the evolution in the world. And it's about moderation. You don't have to, as she just said, you don't have to stay on your phone 24/7. In some instances, it's quicker to send a text. It's in some instances, you'd rather talk to somebody. It just depends on timing. And with our schedules, which are ridiculously crazy, I told you about the 2 o'clock in the morning, waking up at 2 o'clock
in
the morning.
More than mine.
Yeah. I get up a little bit earlier, 2 o'clock in the morning, leaving home at 3 to get to work and be on air by 4:25 in the morning. Yeah, exactly. So You might want to text me instead of try to call me, because I go to bed at 7 o'clock. So, but it's just in how you do things. And we both talk to our kids about social media and being on the phones all the time. It has to be cut off in my house at a certain time, because I'll take it in a minute, because I walk in the house and there's dishes in the sink. But that's a whole other story about parenting.
This is not what the panel is about.
Yeah, that's another panel right there, because I take this. It's in all the stuff is in my room right now as we speak. But I'm just saying, because I took it all because I got mad because dishes were in the sink for more than one day. But that's another.
Do we need Dr. Phil up here?
Yeah, we might need Dr. Phil. We might need Oprah in here for that discussion. But anyway, it's about managing your time and everything being done in moderation.
I'd like to say hello to Jason Smith in the back. He's leaving now. He's one of our photographers.
Yes.
Another position in the business. Thank you for being here. Yeah. From Channel 5.
Thank you so
Bye,
much.
Bye, Jason.
Bye, Jay.
Bye, Jason.
Have a good
seeing you. Tell the boys I said hello. All right. So we here at Prince George's Community College, we like empowering our students. As you saw, Aaron was one of the people that gave an opportunity so he can practice his craft. We have students that have done everything from public relations for this event, marketing, broadcast. So they're doing everything, including on-air talent. So I want to bring up, but before I bring that up, I want to acknowledge our president, Dr. Dukes, who has come in. She's been gracious enough to help us empower the students here. The opportunities that she has afforded this college setting for us to bring programs like this is second to none. I thank you, Dr. Dukes, for that. Do you want to make any remarks at this time? Always want to give you the opportunity, yes. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Wisdom.
See, you can't get that on the phone, see?
Right.
That's what I'm saying. That's a real, real relationship right there.
Okay.
You know, I certainly, I get my news from, you know, Allison Seymour and Wisdom Martin all the time. So I'm really excited that they're here with us, and they're talking to you about what they do, their profession, their craft, but they are also such huge givers back to the community in so many ways. The community service that they do, calling them, asking them to come over here to talk to all of you as you think about what your careers are, both in front of the camera and behind the camera. Wisdom, we'll have a discussion. Because when my son was your daughter's age, not only did I take all of his things, I sent him to my room because I figured all we had was a fat back TV in there. He had everything else.
I'm gonna try that when I get home.
But I wanna thank you all for being here, Professor Holder, for working to put all of this together, because our job is to make sure that you have access to people who can talk to you about their journeys and hopefully help you shape yours. So thank you all for being here, and I'll sit down and listen to some more. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Dukes. All right, coming to the stage now is two of the students from our TV, radio, and film class. Denicia Dunk and Elijah Rashad, could you please come up? So what we did, Allison and Wisdom, everybody was involved here with your visit. We had students send questions to you into a Gmail account, and then another class of mine had to narrow down these questions, and then the questions that are gonna be asked for you right now are the ones that made it to the list. Okay. So the ones that did not make it, they will be answered by Wisdom and Allison at a later time.
Through social
media. But these are some of the questions that came from the students. They didn't come from me.
All right.
They came from the students. So they're going to rattle off some questions to you. And some of them are real good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, good afternoon, guys. Thank you so much for coming out again. It's really a pleasure to have you here. So the first subject that we want to cover, we're just going to jump straight in. This question is for both Mrs. Seymour and Mr. Martin. There are so many tragedies in the world as a whole and right here in our own communities. As broadcasters, you're hearing and telling these stories daily. What methods do you use to decompress and regulate your own emotions after constant coverage of negative news, especially within the African American community?
Boom, right off the top. What did I tell you?
No warm up.
Fastball right down the middle is.
So basically, it is a lot. There's a lot of negative news, and there's a lot of negative things that go on in the African American community that we talk about on a regular basis. But this is not new to us. We've been in the industry for a long time. So we see this, and we talk about this quite a bit. So for me, it's just a matter of some stories are so awful and so bad that you can't help but have it in the back of your mind and start thinking about it. But at some point, you have to be completely professional, present this information to the public, because that's what you're there for, is to present the information to the public. Yes, it's a tragic story. Yes, it's an awful story. It's a story that if you're sitting at home, you could cry, you can get angry, you can get mad. But your job, when you're broadcasting these things, is to put the information, get the information out to the public in a way that they can understand. That is the key. That is the key. Now, as far as decompressing, once you're off the air and you go home, you got life. You can't stop because you got life at your house. The dishes aren't going to wash themselves. Oh, I mentioned those dishes again, huh? So you got to get back. I mean, once you leave work, you got to go back home. You got stuff to do. There are kids. You got the wife. You got the family. Grass needs to be cut. So that's how you decompress, because when you go back home, your world begins. That's your world that starts. So that's how you decompress. But when it comes to reading and delivering all the bad news, it's just a matter of my job is to put that information out there to the public so they can understand what's going on.
I would agree, but sometimes your face tells a story. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when a story is so hurtful and awful, for me, I think about stories, crimes against children, other vulnerable populations. And I think that if you look at what we do, so I do 3 hours of news. I do a three-hour news block. So if I have a terrible story in the first half hour, I can't just be sad and mopey for the rest of the time. You know, why has this happened for the rest of the time? So during the show, I think it's not a problem to show emotion on your face. I've teared up on stories because either it's so outrageous or you're so mad, and you can't imagine that people would treat each other that way. But wisdom is absolutely right. You're there to do a job. I have a three-hour job to do. So I take that story. I'm going to let my emotions, I'm not going to get overboard. I'm not going to be too, outraged or upset or mad. I'm trying to hide it. But what I'm saying is I'm a human being. We're humans. We're family people. So if a little bit of that comes out, that's fine. But I got to compose myself, because you have to be strong moving in, because the broadcast is long. When I get home, there have been some stories that really have stuck with me. And honestly, my dad is a preacher, and I call him. I call him and I say, how can God let this happen? You're going to tell me. I'm on the front lines of hearing this and reporting it. And we talk, and then I move on away from it. But I let myself feel that emotion, and I deal with it, because we have so much over the 20-something years, we've been in the business, so many bad stories, and we'd be a mess. So you have to figure out, just like in life, you have to get your coping mechanism together, and you have to keep getting up to report the next day's news.
Oh, and one more, real quick, to piggyback off of what she just said, a lot of times when there's something that's the crazy that happens, Allison and I will have a conversation about it, because we have to figure out what we're going to tell our children about something that happens. So then we sometimes have that conversation, and then that leads into, when we get home, talking to the children about whatever tragedy happened, because sometimes they'll see it and they will start asking questions. So, I'm a firm believer in, you can't bury your head in the sand when you're dealing with children and just act like, oh no, don't look at that, don't look at that. No, this is the world. This is the world that you're going to be dealing with at some point. So we can deal with it now, get you ready to deal with it, so that when you do have to deal with it, you will be prepared and you'll be ready to deal with all the negative things. Now, it's not all negative, but negative things do happen. Bad things do happen. So you need to be ready and able to cope with when bad things and negative things do happen.
Very well said. And good afternoon again.
Good afternoon.
Thanks for being here. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedules to come speak with us. Going on to the next question is addressed for both Mr. Martin and Mr. Seymour. So as an anchor for Fox 5 News, what would you say is the most challenging and most rewarding part of your day, of your day?
Being here. Being here. I can say that. It's a true story. True story. I mean, coming out, like, seeing all these young faces and for me, my sorors who've come up and said, I'm a soror, Gamma is in the house too somewhere. So it's this real life stuff. We get into the business and you don't know exactly, nobody can tell you this part when you get into the business. You're thinking, I'm going to go to work, I'm going to report, I'm going to, whatever. They don't tell you that you're going to get invited to speak here or there, and you have to make a decision. What kind of person am I going to be? Am I going to give to the community, or am I going to take and never give back? And so that's my favorite part. Meeting the fabulous people that I get to meet too. But probably you touched on the part that is hard, and that is when you don't even understand how the world could produce some news stories like it does, or everything that's going on in society today. Trying to figure that out. But I believe it just makes you a better person. You got to really deal with it. We deal with all that negative stuff is thrown at us every day. And you got to deal with it. So ultimately, it makes you stronger. But my best part, no doubt, is doing things like this.
And it also validates you as well. it gives you a sense of empowerment to know that people are enjoying what you're doing. They do like what you're doing. So when you run into people who actually, and it's not about, trust me, it's not about ego or anything like that, because I by no means don't think, we don't think we're stars at all. But when somebody comes up to you and says, we like what you do with your job, that's very fulfilling. So when we see people, we meet people and talk to people and come out and people are like, oh, we enjoy your job, your presentation or whatever it is, that's very rewarding. And giving back, that's just part of the who you are as a person, if that's what you choose to do. And that's what we like to do. We like to meet people. We like to talk to people. When we go on our zip trips, we have a good time because that's what we're doing. We're just talking to people. We're just regular old folks. She's a D.C. person. I'm a country boy.
Okay. Mrs. Seymour, as we just said, you're a Washingtonian, yes. And you work right here in your hometown market. So your family and friends can turn on the TV and see you at any time. Although it's probably a great feeling, do you also feel any additional pressure not to let your hometown down?
Oh, not at all. I mean, it's like I did, as the host said, my first job was in Utica, New York, Binghamton, Albany, then St. Louis. I wanted to be prepared for y'all when I got back home. Okay? So I worked it out. We still make mistakes, you know, I'll stumble over something, not know how to say a name, whatever. I'm a human being. But there is no greater feeling than when your mom calls you after the show, rest in peace, mom, when your mom calls you after the show and says, you know, I like when you said this today. You know, I like when you did that. Or when you're in a supermarket and somebody's like, Allison? And I'm like, yeah, hey. And I'm assuming they watched the show. No, I went to school with you in the second grade, girl. So it's just the best feeling. It's the best, you know, and it's honest. If I'm going to be a success, I want to do it in D.C. And if I fail, I want to do it here. You know, some people feel like, okay, New York is, if I can make, you know the song, if I can make it there, that's the pinnacle. For me, I always wanted to come home to D.C., so I'm living that dream.
And I always wanted to come to your home, D.C.
And you are very welcome, Wisdom.
All right, so being that some of the students here at Prince George's Community College are studying the communications industry, Mr. Martin, what are some specific tips that you can give students who would like to enhance their communication skills?
All right, a couple of things. Real quick, you have to be up on current events. Always be up on current events. As I was saying when I was outside, I was doing an interview outside. You have to be far more prepared than the next person. It's not about what school you go to. It's not about going to the big schools, not about going to the small school. It's about individuals and drive and ambition. So you have to decide, when you're at whatever career you're going after, how much drive, how much ambition, what am I willing to do to succeed in this career? You have to be more than prepared. I was saying outside that if the person ahead of you is there 30 minutes early, you need to be there an hour earlier. If the person ahead of you read one book, you need to read two. You just have to be far more prepared and far more well-read than the competition. And you never stop learning, never stop growing, never stop evolving. You always have to be hungry, no matter what the situation is, because it's not about money. Don't let money drive you. Money's good, keeps the lights on, but don't let money drive you. It's about ambition, setting your goals, and what you want out of whatever situation that you're going after. Because it's going to be tough. You're going to have a lot of ups and downs. Make no mistake about it, lots of ups and downs. So that's why you have to really want it, really be willing to do it, and be ready and prepared when the opportunity presents itself. Network, meet as many people as possible, network as much as possible. In this age of social media, there's no excuse for not knowing, because you can Google anything. So just be ready. Be ready.
Okay, we're halfway done. The next question is for Mrs. Seymour and Mr. Martin again. I know you both have kids. I heard you coach your kids' basketball team and your family's.
Use the term coach loosely. Coach Carter.
And your families are very important to you, but your job is very demanding. So have you ever had to miss any special family or friend events? And how do you keep your professional and personal lives from clashing?
Aren't these questions good, guys?
They're very good.
Yeah.
You're going to have to miss some events, but that's life. And I think that the events that you go to, the time that you spend with your children, like I can't be at something that's at 8 o'clock in the morning, but the conversation with my, you know, all the time, sometimes, but as a rule, I'm going to have to do what I do for a living. And so I think that if you have an honest conversation, open and honest, with your children, then they know where your heart is. If you're always working, okay, no, you look like a phony. You're a fraud. You're letting them down. And that's what I don't do. But they, at this point, you know, it's kind of cool that their mom's on TV, too. So, you know, it is what it is. And I think life is not getting caught up in the guilt of what you can't do if you're honest about it. So I work in the morning. I am there at 2:30 when my kids are out of school to pick them up. Do you know what I mean? And I'm not hanging out. I'm not going to everything at night because that's my time because of my schedule. So, and I have to let myself off the hook for the things that I can't be at 8 o'clock in the morning. Right. But make no mistake about it, my number one priority is my family. Right. Number one. Yeah. So you just work around it.
Yeah. I agree. And in fact, because of our schedules, just like Allison said, in the afternoon, we're there in the afternoon. Now, I have to go to bed super early, so a lot of stuff we can't do together, but the time that from the time I pick them up to the time I go to bed at 7 o'clock, 7:30, hey, we're doing it. We are doing it, and on the weekends, we're doing it. We spend quality time together. As she said, you can't make it. There's no way you can make every single thing, and they know that because we've had that conversation. So go in there and do what you need to do so I can go to bed at 7 o'clock.
Wash the dishes.
Make sure the house is ready to go.
Wash those dishes. We get it. Wash those dishes at the Martin household.
Wash those dishes so Daddy can go to bed and don't make any noise, so Daddy can go to bed at 7 o'clock. But they're good. You know what? Like she said, if you're having an honest conversation with your children, they understand that you have to go to bed at a certain time and you have to be ready. They know you got to work. They know. They understand. And when they get their Game Boys and all this other, what they don't, not Game Boys, I'm sorry, I just dated myself.
Game Boys?
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Ataris.
I know.
Really?
When they get their Ataris.
Pong?
Yeah, come when on, they get Pong.
Game Boys.
When they get Cubert, they know it's not free.
So. Woo!
I'm going to stop talking now. I'm sleep deprived.
You know what? As long as they know your heart, you have a, you know, I would be, if they were here right now and you asked that question, has mom missed out on anything? They would say, well, some things she can't go to, but no, she was there and support in every way possible. Okay. You just gotta make it a priority.
All right. So addressing my last question, I wanna thank you, Mr. Martin, for enlightening us with your wisdom. no pun intended.
That's a good one.
We didn't rehearse that,
you
Elijah.
You ain't never heard that one before.
Never heard that.
We didn't rehearse that.
More importantly, as you mentioned earlier, social media is ever-changing and ever-growing in the world we live in today. So what would you say is your favorite social media platform and why? And that's for both Mrs. Seymour and Mr. Martin.
Why do you make your face up like that, Wisdom?
What is that?
Social media. All right, so I guess my favorite social media is the one that the kids say is for old folks now, which is Facebook.
Facebook.
It's for that's the old folks' social media. And here's why, because I got there's a lot of friends and family members all over the country. It's easy, you can keep up with them, no pressure. The one I don't like, Twitter. Because anybody, like, you can get on Twitter right now and say you're Billy Ray Cyrus, put up a picture of Billy Ray Cyrus, and then you can...
No, they don't know who Billy Ray Cyrus is.
I know, okay. You can say
you
that
you think of anybody better than Billy Ray Cyrus?
I'm going old school here today.
Okay, obviously.
You can put up a picture right now and say your name is Kirk Cousins, all right? And put Kirk Cousins' picture up on social media right now, and you can troll me all day. Wisdom Martin, you stink. I hate your guts, you can't read the news, blah, 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 and then it's just like, there's no consequence, there's no repercussion to that. Anybody can do anything, I'm gonna be completely honest with y'all. People send us the craziest junk on Twitter. We get naked pictures, people send us porn, they says, on Twitter. This is out in the open, this is not, and.
I get it on Facebook too, though.
Oh, you do? Oh, I don't get it on Facebook. But I do get it on Twitter. I mean, it is ridiculous, but. Facebook is my favorite one because it's real simple, and you kind of have to let people in on Facebook, so that's why I like that too. You can kind of filter it a little bit better. Twitter is just out there. Anybody can get on Twitter and say anything crazy about you and make up stuff and send you dirty pictures. It's awful.
Wisdom.
People.
Wisdom. Who has sent you some dirty pictures?
I don't know these people.
Have you gotten dirty pictures?
I've gotten some dirty pictures.
You did?
Yes.
What?
And I deleted them. I did. I deleted it, and I reported it to the proper authorities at the
Your
TV
wife.
Station. Yes.
Okay.
Yes, and then I was doing the dishes, And I'm not even guilty.
There's those dishes again. My goodness, brother. Everything goes back to the dishes.
Everything goes back to the dishes. I hate dishes.
That is so funny. See, I have a different experience. I really love Twitter.
You do?
Yeah, I do. I love Twitter, and you're absolutely right. I mean, but you can make up a fake profile or whatever, but Twitter, you're right, is more, yeah. It seems more instant or right to you. But I feel the connectivity on Twitter is just a little bit more immediate, and the negative stuff you're going to get, that's personally the one that I like the best. Yeah, I like that one.
Okay.
And Instagram is more so for me. You know, Fox, it has something to do with the station, but that's really where I love to put, like, my family, kids, and where we want to do a little dance routine and everything.
I follow Fox 5 DC on Twitter. I've seen that.
Wait, what? Snapchat? We don't do Snapchat. That's for the young folks.
The station has a Snapchat.
Oh, they do? Mm-hmm. All right, we don't do Snapchat. That's the one with the disappearing video, right? No?
But now it's the filter.
Oh, is it? I don't even know what that is. I'm social media'd out, so I can't do Snapchat.
Okay, so as a broadcaster, what steps do you take to identify proper English etiquette in your field? Because I've noticed that a lot of people use slang terms to stay current or make it more conversational, but what would be the proper etiquette?
Well, it's different in TV news. We have TV news writing that is, you probably wouldn't talk like some of the scripts are written, but for some reason it works. I'm trying to think of an example. It's just shortened, it's a little quicker, and people seem to be able to decipher what you're saying. You know what I mean, Wiz?
Yeah, I'm trying to think of something.
It's just a different way to, you wouldn't write the same way for a newspaper article, for example, as you do for television news or radio. It's just a different feeling. But grammar has to be correct. You know, so many times when you see like a group of men so the singular with the group and that kind of thing, that still drives me crazy. A group was, of course, you know, it's a singular thing. So the basic rules apply, but TV news writing is sort of shortened. It's a little, it could seem choppier if I'm talking to you about it, but it's just a style thing. But the rules of grammar, they still apply, like where is spelt a certain way as opposed to where versus where, you know, so all those rules still apply. But I will agree with you, Luke, because I get the sense that you really hate social media and texting and all of this.
Only when I don't hate it, but I just think a lot of people, and I'm just going to be honest, like some of the students, they are so comfortable with texting that I'm trying to teach them like to write thank you letters. And some of the thank you letters are like
the text. Well, we got to do something about it.
So it's not that I don't like it. I just feel that it's pervading the younger generation so much so that everything, like happy birthday, HBD, spell out happy birthday.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like take the time to spell out happy birthday.
Right.
But that is the culture now. I'm trying to keep up with it. Mm-hmm. But when it starts to invade these kids getting jobs, because you only get one chance to make a first impression.
Right.
And when you put that in there and you are, oh, I didn't know the difference between, you know, because I'm doing it all the time, that's when I have a problem.
Okay.
And that's what I'm teaching, that, okay, you guys got to slow down.
Right.
We got to learn how to speak English.
Right.
And we got to learn how to write.
Right.
Right? You got to take the time.
Right.
Right? Because there's only so much that Professor Holder or anybody can go back and say, look, they were just learning. No. Mm-hmm. They're responsible now for the actions that they take.
Right.
Right? Not only posting stuff on social media, but writing a thank you letter.
Well, that's it. Yeah. So the art of that, like I wouldn't be on the news and say, you know, HBD whoever. So that's some common sense thing here. And I think the onus is on the field of academics, but also at home too, to do that. Like none of my kids is writing a thank you note that's like with the shortcuts, but it is a lost art. And I think that is the downside, but proper English is always proper English. And at the end of the day, that's what we all need.
Right.
When I was at Hampton, I think we took a grammar class like every year. Grammar 101, 201, yeah. So I don't know if they still do that, but yeah. No, kids are like, nope. Sure don't.
I could answer you that.
Sure
I could
not.
Answer that.
Okay, so when your television broadcasting career is over, what other aspirations do you have for the future? And do they include communications? I know for you specifically, Mr. Martin, you help coach You said, okay, you help coach your children's basketball.
Loose term, coach.
Is that something you furthermore enjoy doing after the broadcasting days are over?
Sure, I'll coach the kids. I hope for the best. Now, I wouldn't mind that. My father was a basketball coach, and he was a high school math teacher as well. So I love coaching. I love the competition of sports and getting involved with the kids and getting them to follow structure and the spirit of competition. I love all that. So yeah, I would love to do that at some point when I'm retired.
See, let's be honest. You don't have to do anything because men are allowed to get old on TV. Right? I mean, you can do that until you retire, and don't lie. With me, I will have to figure out what else I'm trying to do. And
you want to be assistant coach?
Let me just do that. I thought about what I do want to do, and I would love to actually, maybe go back to my home by the sea down at Hampton and teach a course or two and, do whatever. Volunteer. I'm trying to get this money right so I can just retire. But it's a struggle and it's real. But I do think about like life afterwards. And that is the thing. It's got to think about what this job translates into. And a lot of people used to go into public relations. That was what people did when they just left. They went into public relations. But those jobs aren't what they used to be anymore. And I'm not sure that that's really what I would want. It would just be like, okay, old news people go into public relations. But I don't know. I got to think about what it is I want to do. I got to think about that.
All right. Great questions by Elijah and Denise. Let's give them a round
of applause. Good job.
This Changing Face of Communication Forum was constructed to provide yet another empowering opportunity for our students to gain insight and exposure from individuals actually working in the industry. And as you just witnessed, that insight and that exposure were clearly captured. Special thanks to all the awesome folks at PGCC-TV who make sure events like this on the college campus are captured and broadcast to you. Lives are being transformed at this college, and what you just witnessed was thought-provoking change that our students, our faculty, and even the residents of this fine county can be proud of. To learn more about what's going on at Prince George's Community College, visit our website, www.pgcc.edu. I'm Lou Holder, and thanks for watching.